Hey everybody, welcome back to First Frequency of One, it's Shock Metaphysics. It's me, the ball wonder himself, back with you as the metaphysical Morpheus, aka Reverend Dr. Philippe Shock Matthews, and I've got a juggernaut with me. I've got a man who has inspired me and is partly responsible for my business acumen. I had him on my radio show back in 2013. I know that seems a lifetime ago, does it not? But I had this man on and he told me exactly what to do to become successful. And here we are many years later, honored to have him back with us on our live platform, Dr. George Fraser. How are you, my beloved?
I am doing incredible, Reverend Dr. Philippe Shock Matthews. I love that name, right? As I said to you the other day, there should be an H-E right before Reverend, right? His Majesty. His Excellence, Reverend Dr. Philippe Shock.
I love it. I love it. From your mouth to God's ears, and let's make it happen. Let's try that with the wife. I don't think she's going to go for it too well.
No. Right.
Honey, you have to call me His Royal Highness. His Highness. No. I'll be knocking on your door. I'll probably have a suitcase with me. But anyway.
All right.
I am honored to have you here because of a lot of the things that you're involved in. Right now, of course, we're going to talk about the Power Networking Conference, which is going to be huge. It's going to be in Charlotte, North Carolina this year for the first time. So we got a lot to talk about and unpack on that. But one of the conversations that you and I had offline was talking about, and you talked about this, I think, on Every Dot Black with Dr. Jimmy Davis. You talked about the concept of DEI, diversity, equity, and inclusion. And you opened it up on the platform on that talk, talking about there was, you know, three different kind of things that happened. You know, there's the Jim Crow, there was diversity, equity, and inclusion, there was something else. And Florida has been going absolutely crazy with, you know, banning DEI, critical race theory, the fear of that. And so I wanted to have you come on and enlighten us as to why have whites killed diversity, equity, and inclusion?
That's a deep question.
For a deep man.
I'm going to give you my 30,000 foot meta view on that.
Okay.
Basically six things, money and power. The grand replacement theory.
Yes.
To add more complexity, and where complexity, because God doesn't make things, complicated. We make things complicated. Yeah. One of the reasons we make things complicated is to control power. So the less you understand about it, the more power I have over you. So complexity. Of course, the standard superiority and supremacy, which is the continuing feeding of that, which is literally hundreds of years old and deeply embedded in the conscious and subconscious mind, and competitive advantage. The more diversity, equity, and inclusion there is, the more cultural minority excellence, in particular Black excellence, is revealed, and our creative power and our real history is revealed people really get to know who the hell we really are. It weakens their competitive advantage in the marketplace, and discomfort. White people really don't feel comfortable being less than. It makes them, when diversity, equity, and inclusion makes them feel uncomfortable. We hear those remarks all the time. It just, if it doesn't fit into their whole idea of colorblindness and meritocracy, right, which colorblindness, of course, has been poo-pooed.
Absolutely.
It's morally wrong. You don't see my color. You don't see my culture. You don't see me. So that's baloney. And you know, and so they're not real comfortable with the way things are moving, because DEI, there's no question, Doc, that it drives results. There's just no question about that.
Absolutely.
But if a company is doing it because they don't want to be canceled, so to speak, or criticized, it really doesn't work, right? DEI, the bubble is popping right now. Extreme critique. There's been major corporate reversing of their initiatives. Google made a big announcement that completely getting rid of DEI. The economic markets say that if you are a corporation and DEI is a big part of your human resource strategy, it's going to have an impact on your stock prices.
Wow.
Yeah, on your stock prices. Now, I've said many, many times for many, many years, if you really want to mess with white people, mess with their money.
Okay. So, right.
So we didn't hear the term DEI really before George Floyd. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Then suddenly there was a mass rush to hire DEI leadership, but most of it was just for show. This is what
absolutely.
It was treated like an initiative or a program, and then they hired a leader for that program or initiative, but they gave them no resources, they gave them no support, and so it was destined to fail.
Right. Okay.
You've got to fund that which you really believe in. But research has shown that blue chip firms like, let's say, the McKinsey Corporation has done major studies on this, clearly shows that it drives results. And companies who get it are doubling down on it because it does get results. There's just no question about it. Most people don't understand what diversity, equity, and inclusion is, and they're viewing it as some radical affirmative action program. And that's not what it is. Okay, it's about
someone just asked a question: is DEI popping from the fall of affirmative action?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I'll take them through that in a moment. But really, DEI is about creating a culture of inclusion. Mm-hmm. And the question that I ask when I speak in corporate America: do you want your employees to feel like they belong here, right? So that they will feel passionate about the work that they are doing. Of course, companies want people to be passionate about the work that they're doing. So it's about a diverse approach to solving problems, to getting better results, and making more money. That's at the end of the day, everybody wins. It's a win-win-win. But DEI is not new. It began in the 1960s with the great society programs of Lyndon Baines Johnson in the 60s. And you know, that's where we got, and this is really the major contribution that boomers made. This will be our legacy, and it was aimed at to combat poverty and racial injustice through various initiatives. And out of that came the Civil Rights Act of 1964, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, Fair Housing, right, 1968. So three major things were accomplished in the 60s through the Great Society programs in the 60s. And then in the 70s and 80s, due to the incredible work of Congressman Perrin Mitchell, one of the 13 founding members of the Congressional Black Caucus, set aside programs where a certain percentage of government contracts, I don't know if you remember that or not, and resources were specifically allocated for minority-owned businesses, and including certainly Black folks in America. And while these programs basically were aimed to promote economic equity, they faced a lot of legal challenges back then, and then scrutiny over concerns of reverse discrimination. It wasn't making white folks feel good, and they thought that black people's was getting business that they should have gotten because they were qualified, or they were there first, or they were bigger, etc. And so they faced a lot of challenges with set aside programs. Then the next iteration of diversity, equity, inclusion was affirmative action. That actually began in the 60s and is still going on today, right? Affirmative action. And this is this was introduced into Congress to address historical discrimination and to promote diversity in education, employment, and contracting. And so while initially it was seen as a way to level the playing field, these programs faced legal challenges and controversy with debates over their effectiveness and fairness, and that continues to this day. We still have affirmative action, but it has somewhat taken a back seat to diversity, equity, and inclusion, and now diversity, equity, and inclusion is getting the big heat and might probably be eliminated and maybe be, you know, birth some other new initiative. I know that there is another new initiative that was to replace diversity, equity, inclusion if it survives, and that one is diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging. And belonging. Right? That's the new one. So we'll see. So a lot of people didn't understand diversity, equity, and inclusion. And therefore, it's being abandoned in the major corporate, public, and private sector inititives.
I've seen some memes from whites that say diversity is extinction for them. That's how radical they see it.
Yeah, that's the great replacement theory. Mm-hmm. That's the great replacement theory, which has been debunked. That white people think they're ultimately going to be replaced by cultural minorities and immigrants. Now, there is a shred of truth to that. If we just look at the demographics. There are 8 billion people in the world. 16% of those people are white people. The rest are people of color.
Yep.
So as I tell black people, we're not outnumbered, we're out-organized.
I like that, right? Yes.
And the critical and strategic thinking that is necessary to sustain white supremacy, right, and superiority takes a lot of critical thinking, a lot of conniving, a lot of misdirection. And so they are, and at 16% of the population and 88% of the population don't look like them. That you got to be really smart to maintain that system.
Seriously,
right? I mean, smart would be one word. It could be conniving and evil too. You could.
We definitely want to put that in there based upon what we've seen.
Right. So that's, you know, that's really. That's the fight that we're in at this moment in time. And as it relates to black people, if you look at this as a fight with them, quite frankly, it is a toothpick fighting a sword. Right? Will we resolve this? Yes. All of this, all of the isms, racism, white supremacy, all of that will ultimately be resolved. And so, Dr. Fraser, how long do you think that will take? I think it'll take about 100 years. We didn't get this way overnight. We're not going to solve it overnight. I think it's going to take another 3 to 5 generations. So how will it happen? We will screw our way out of it. In 100 years, with the race.
I love your mind. I love this interracial
marriage. By the way, it has quadrupled in the last 15 years. Interracial.
Absolutely. They're trying to go back home. That's the only way they're going to survive.
Right? In 100 years, you won't know who's who.
I don't know if that's a good thing. It's like, how do you maintain?
I'm just saying that's what it is.
You're absolutely right. The demographics, the numbers absolutely add up and support exactly what you're saying.
Look at the numbers. We are outbirthing, right? Almost every cultural group in the world is having more children per family than white people. They're barely replacing themselves. In fact,
Replacement. Yeah, it's called a birth dearth. Yeah, look it up, family. We've done a lot of work on this. Yes.
Right. And well, because of essentially anything we did, right? It's because of something they ain't doing. Right. And, just look at Africa. Right? I mean, the average 4 to 6 children per family.
Absolutely. Right? Absolutely.
So at some point in time, the numbers are going to flip everything.
Absolutely.
Right? 100%. No question about that. And then commingling, interracial marriages. In fact, you can hardly see an ad on television today.
You cannot.
Without seeing an interracial couple.
That's right. That's right.
All right. So is that a way of thinning our blood? What's happening here?
Yeah.
Thinning our blood?
That's right? Exactly, so what's happening.
Because, you know, this is the trope that the Donald Trump is speaking, right?
Mm-hmm,
immigrants and others, you know, are sort of thinning our population and thinning our blood. So so the long term, we won't be around. We won't be around. All right, this is, it's a 100-year trek, but that's the direction that it is going. And so we understand that diversity, equity, and inclusion, we look at it just at the surface, it's about money and power.
Mm-hmm.
It's about avoiding the great replacement theory that they are caught up on. It is about not the willingness to deal with the complexities of resolving it, right? And the commitment to resolve it, right? It's still about white supremacy and white superiority, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, even though they were the minority part, even when they brought slaves over, right? By the millions, you had a fewer number of white people than ultimately the number of slaves that they were abusing.
Mm-hmm.
That took violence, hanging, killing, subjugation, reminding people or erasing people's memories because they knew who we were.
Mm-hmm.
Right? We just didn't know who we were. 100 or 150 years later, 200 years later. So that is what they had to do to control a body of people that essentially, from a demographic standpoint, outnumbered them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right. So the head job that you got to do on those people to keep them subjugated and cowering and terrorized. Is evil.
Absolutely.
It's just evil. So
do you feel that we are in kind of like a neo Jim Crow era? It's very difficult for Black men to get employment, to get education, to get any level of parity. There is a direct divide and conquer strategy to separate Black men and Black women, both economically and academically.
Absolutely.
Your thoughts on this neo Jim Crow concept, and then I really want to get into what we can do about it. And what we can do about it is have our Black butts at the George Fraser Power Networking Conference coming up.
That's so, certainly that's certainly one of the key things, because the conference is 23 years old. And by the way, we have been talking about this for 23 years. All right. So this is a new conversation to us.
Absolutely.
23 years ago, we didn't call it diversity, equity, and inclusion. That's a relatively new name. Right. Back then, we were calling it affirmative action. We were looking at set aside programs, wondering how long they would last. And if ultimately there would be an uprising and black people, I mean, white people would feel that they were being abused and they were being, looked over for, for opportunities in favor of Hispanics and black and brown people. So there was another, it was the same battle. It was the same battle. Because it a slightly different mindset, but the same fundamental battle when you really think about it.
Sure.
And so we're still fighting this.
That's absolutely right.
So this is 50 years. So
50 years. Hold on, Doc. Kaylee from the UK, she says diversity, equity, and inclusion is beginning over here in the United Kingdom. And she's saying DEI jobs are being eliminated and not replaced. So this is not just here. This is traversing around the world.
Right.
They're trying to keep and collect their power, keep their numbers up and in power, but it ain't working because people like George Fraser, who keep getting up doing these power networking conferences for the last generation, for literally an entire generation.
Right. That's right.
So I want to be able to say personally, by just knowing this man and knowing of his work, how it's altered my life and shaped me as a, not just as a man, but as a black man. So in my opinion, now is it's crucial and critical to get as many people, particularly young people, active in the power network as possible. Mm-hmm. So I know I just unloaded a lot onto you. So we wanted to talk about the Neo Jim Crow piece, but then, you know, let's come up and start bringing in the efficacy and the urgency, because we're in an urgent state. I'm always feeling like we're in an urgent state, but we're in an urgent state. And there are not community, a lot of conferences of this ilk, of this status, and of this longevity that has had such a high success rate. Even Forbes said that, I think like 2 years in a row or some crazy number, that this is the conference to be at. I mean, come on. So,
the top five,
we need to get some action going here. Go ahead, beloved.
One of the top five conferences in America, not to be missed. Not one of the top five black conferences, but one of the top five of all conferences put on in this country. So that's a hell of an accolade, right?
Yeah, it is.
And so it's like if you're an actor and you get an Academy Award, right? It will always say, when you're in the next movie, let's say you got it 5 years ago or 10 years ago, it will always say Academy Award winning, right?
Absolutely.
In fact, when you die, I tell people this, if you got an Academy Award or an Emmy Award or a Grammy Award or a Pulitzer Prize or a Nobel Prize, when you die, here's what the obituary is going to say. Nobel Prize winning.
That's right.
Toni Morrison. So the prize will come before her name. Academy Award winning Denzel Washington.
Right.
So it's something I know that we espouse all the time since we've gotten that recognition, but it's a very, very, very high recognition. We're very, very, very proud of it. And we're very, very excited to be in Charlotte, the Queen City, right? Very excited about that. I mean, and there's a lot of retro migration going on in our culture, and Charlotte is really near the top.
That's what I'm hearing. Yeah. I heard that. There was a whole documentary on this, as a matter of fact. That's fascinating. Let's consolidate, go back and kind of have a black planet again, at least with multiple zip codes around it. Now, the mayor of Charlotte, actually, in community, there's a link I'm going to put into the chat. There's a blog that I put up on behalf of the Power Conference with Dr. George Fraser, where the mayor is actually personally welcoming you to Charlotte, North Carolina. Why Charlotte? What happened here?
Well, I have a lot of good friends in Charlotte. And, you know, we don't keep the conference in one city more than 3 years.
Okay.
So, of course, we were in Houston. We ended up in Houston because I had a very, very good friend who lobbied me for 5 years while we were in other cities. He said, you got to bring it to Houston. It's the fourth largest Black population in America. Very progressive, lots of opportunities. You know, a lot of people are curious about and they would want to visit, right? So I don't have to tell you that Tony Jackson and Marlon Smith lobbied me for 3 or 4 years. But of course, I've always liked Charlotte. My sister moved from New York City to Charlotte. So I've visited Charlotte on a number of occasions and I've just always liked it. In fact, I had actually gotten my wife of 51 years to agree to move to Charlotte.
Okay? Wow.
Yeah. I mean, imagine.
That's a big deal.
So we should all go to
the conference just on that, on the merits of that alone, family. You don't understand what it takes to make all a sister of 51 years move.
So brothers and sisters, you can kill two birds with one stone. You can come to the conference and get some of the best training, coaching, mentoring, specific education as it relates to starting, building, and scaling business.
Yes.
Starting, building, and properly managing your wealth, and understanding and learning about the power of the human connection, or effective networking, or effectively connecting the dots. Those are the three subjects that we cover. And we cover them like a rug, and we've always had the best and brightest and baddest sisters and brothers on the planet in those subject matter areas. And so you could take each of those three subject matter areas and you could do a whole workshop on one aspect of that subject if you're talking about business. And if you're talking about business, you could have another workshop on branding. You can have a workshop on starting a business. You can have a workshop on scaling a business because it's too much to put into one workshop. So that's how we do it. So everything that you want to know about starting, growing, and building a business and scaling a business, you get that information and you make some powerful contacts with brothers and sisters who are there.
So this is the ultimate DEI and Jim Crow killer. How do you you really want to kill DEI? And all of let's come to the Power Networking Conference. You're going to figure out, and even reparations, because what I love about your philosophy is that reparations is self-reparation, it's self-repair. You have to repair it yourself. And conference is not just about established people. I want the people who have been told that you don't have a business idea or that you can't run a business, or maybe you have some vacant esteem issues where you've been talked out of living your dream or accessing your dream. You can, I know these people. You can be around these people and 3 days can change the direction of the rest of your life.
That's right. I mean, it couldn't be said any better than that. So we have all of that. We have diversity because we are not a monolithic people.
Right.
And when you talk about the Black culture, you're talking about every shade of Black you could possibly imagine, from light Black like me to chocolate. Right. Licorice and everything in between. And that's what you're going to find. The thing that we're really talking about is culture, right?
Yes.
More so than color,
right?
We're all over the place when it comes to shades and colors. And
absolutely.
It's a beautiful thing. And if you go to Egypt, for example, and you go into the pyramids or the valleys of the Valley of the Kings, and you look and you go in those tombs, you will see Egyptians. And by the way, everybody, Egypt is in Africa now. You will see Egyptians,
right?
Every color that we are,
right? Well,
right,
we are the first people. We created all different ethnicities and cultures. Everything came from us, including what we consider to be white people.
That
came from us. So there are no, like the thing in my meme in the back, nothing's wrong with Black people, something happened. to Black people, and it's still happening. And it's people like George Fraser for the last, actually it's beyond 25 or 23 years, because you were doing this before you launched the Power Network.
That's right. 40
and,
years.
And yeah, yeah. And so we're looking at an individual that, you know, has been pretty much standing the test of time. And as a result of understanding that we are the only culture, we are the first culture, we're the first people. And in that culture, we're so diverse, as he said. There's everything, there's all of us, because we are the original people. We are the first frequency. And this conference is a first frequency, celebrating that at the highest level, but not a conference that you'll go to and say, oh, that was a fun conference. No, this was a transformational moment.
Yeah.
George's conferences are transformational. A lot of the conferences, and not taking anything away, I've been to, are informational. You want to go and you want to get the latest information on a particular industry that you want to go into or investigate or learn more about to, you know, to edge your skills and core competencies. That's great. There's some of that too. But can you transform? Can you go from what my mother, I can't say it on screen, but it's going from SHIT to sugar. Can you go from that to that? What conference can I go to that I know when I come out of that conference and get back on that plane and I have to go back to whatever drove me to this situation in the first place, that I'm leaving out of there differently, permanently, than what brought me to it? And that's what I want you to discuss. And that's why I'm excited to have you with me on my platform, because I just know your power. I've seen it. I have felt it. I have done it. I've done the impossible because George Fraser showed me how. Mm-hmm. I'm not supposed to be here. I'm not supposed to have this platform. I'm not supposed to be Reverend Doctor. I'm not supposed to be that. You know what we're supposed to be, all, especially Black brothers. We're supposed to be out here criming and skiming and doing all kinds of things to try to just scrape and eat. No, George gave me a blueprint. So this conference can give you a blueprint, not just for you. If you are of a certain age and you feel you're jaded, you really need to come to the conference, but also your children. Now, George, you do something. I don't know if this is something you've done before, but I assume you have. The tables, you have a sponsorship package that you talk about. And the table, when a sponsor purchases a table, that table, I think 8 of those seats have to go to a young person.
Well, yeah. So one of the our sponsorship packages targets the public, private, and independent sector or institutions, organizations, and companies.
Okay.
We encourage them to buy a table at the big Friday luncheon, and there's 8 seats at the table, and 2 seats go to whoever represents the corporation or the institution that bought the table. And the other seats go to HBCU or students, Black students.
Wow. Now,
in addition to them being able to have lunch around all of these incredibly brilliant people, it also gives them a full registration for the entire conference.
Oh, my gosh. Really?
Yes. To a full registration for the entire conference. So you're going to. You're going to scholarship, in a sense, 6 very, very, very fortunate young people who would love to be there, but, you know, they're students and they really can't afford that kind of ticket price. So sure. That's a scholarship in your name. That's tax deductible, by the way. And then you will just, you know, further their growth and development, because you talked about it, you suggested it. What is the Power Networking experience? Because we've reframed it, rebranded. The Power Networking experience and expo. Okay. You're going to see a huge display of some of the best and brightest Black-owned businesses, generally speaking, and whomever the corporate sponsors may be, who are very interested in providing you opportunity, looking at your products and services, because they also need diversity in suppliers as well. They need diversity in employment, but they also understand that they're there because you could be a potential customer of whatever product or service that they're providing. So the conference provides you cultural enrichment, economic growth, I'm just netting it out, what I call social cohesion. The more of us who are established and aspiring brothers and sisters, kings and queens, the more those kinds of people that you are around,
absolutely,
the higher your propensity will be to want to be like that.
Absolutely.
And it provides you representation of the best and brightest in Black business excellence,
sure,
in our culture. It provides you equal opportunity, right? Because that's what you want. You want to be around people not only who can help shape your opportunity, but put you in the right places at the right time. It involves you skills in innovation and problem solving, right? That's what it, I do, because that's what we have to do.
How to think.
Mm-hmm. Right. It provides you psychological health and well-being. It gives you a deep historical perspective on who we are, understanding the roots to this tree. And if you don't understand the roots, it is difficult for you to grow. So it provides you a lot of things that make you whole, a 100%
human
being.
And it's restoration and reparation. I love it.
Yeah, it's a beautiful way to say that. And it provides you entrance into our own cultural meritocracy.
Yes,
right? Because the brightest come to this conference, yes, because they want to be around the best and the brightest. When I talk about networking, I say all the time, introduce me to your five closest friends and that will tell me who you are. So go you. So there is a whole plethora of information that will infect, affect, and effect your conscious and subconscious mind and your skills building. And that's okay. What you need, because if you're Black and mediocre in America, you better leave, because you're going to be marginalized. We cannot afford to be mediocre. Black people can't. No. White people can be mediocre, but we can't be mediocre. Right. We have to be freaking amazing. Right? Exceptional. So we want those who come to the conference over almost a quarter of a century are those who aspire to be exceptional, and they want to meet the right kind of people who are also exceptional. They want to establish relationships, garner the information that they can from them, and stay connected to them. Yes. So it's a whole family of benefits, if you will.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You will get just to immerse yourself in that environment, because at our conference, because we don't have tens of thousands of people. See, at a conference where there are thousands of people, you're a spectator. We don't want you to be a participant, which means we want you to meet people, engage people, talk to people, the best and brightest people. We want you to be engaged. We don't have workshops with, 1,000 people. We have workshops with 40 or 50 people. It's hand-to-hand combat, right?
Mm-hmm.
Close, personal. And so in the name of transparency, the first 3 years of the Power Networking Conference, starting in 2002, I sent you a little video. The first one had 8,000 people.
Wow.
The second one was 9,000, and the third was 10,000. And then I said, I don't want to do this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's wonderful, but it turns out to be entertainment and a social event.
Right.
Try to manage 10,000 brothers and sisters and getting them appropriately and timely into workshops. And, we had a workshop, I remember, just like yesterday, Jelle Van Zandt back in the day was one of the major speakers. And we had a workshop with Jelle Van Zandt. There were 2,000 people in her workshop. Well, that's not a workshop, right? That's a keynote speech.
Right.
So you want to change the culture of the conference to make it smaller so that you literally can get a chance to meet everybody. And interact. Speakers come and they stay. So it's a different kind of conference. Again, not putting down anybody's conference. You know, we need as many conferences around needed subject matter. You articulated some of that subject matter as humanly possible. And because Black people miss each other, we really do miss each other.
We really do.
Get together around a cause that is educating and informing and empowering us, we ought to be doing that.
That's absolutely right. And you also have, speaking of entertainment, you also have entertainment as well. So you know, I want people to understand that this is a conference. So you're going to learn, but then you're going to have fun as well. Talk to us about some of the entertainment or entertainers that will be a part of this, as you do every year.
Now, we always have, generally speaking, a sister who does a song or two at luncheons. And then, of course, we have a big party at the end. We only have one party. It's on Saturday night. We've called it the Wakanda Party, and everybody is required to attend with in African attire. And then we have a fashion show. And then we an African attire fashion show. And if you happen to have the most original, most innovative, most beautiful male or female African attire, you win prizes and awards. But at that, at the Wakanda Party, which is what it's themed, there's entertainment. Of course, we you know, it's the last thing we do. It starts at 9, ends at about midnight, and we're partying. You know, there's a meal served, there's dancing, there's a show, there's entertainment. So, and then we have entertainment dispersed in small parts throughout the conference. And then we have another kind of entertainment. This is going to be the first time we're doing it in Charlotte. We're going to have a golf tournament. Now, it's not
bring talk golf to about that. Top golf.
No, it's going to be a Top Golf, right? So you don't have to bring anything. All the clubs and stuff are there. You can be around brothers and sisters that know the game or love the game or just really trying to learn the game and have some fun. So that's a different kind of entertainment. It's a combination of competition, exercise, and learning something new if you're not into golf. Now, I tell sisters all the time, if you want to meet some awesome brothers, learn how to play golf. You will be a minority of one. System, right? And it's going to be all guys. All of them must be pretty well off because golf is not a cheap game to play.
That's right.
And it's a difficult game to learn. So, you know, what you're picking from with all these brothers and you with one or two sisters, you got the creme de la creme. So it's a good way to start to learn that game if you're a sister. And then if you're a young person, it's certainly an incredible game. It's one of the most important games you can learn for effective networking because you spend 4 hours with a group of four, let's say brothers, or and of course now our sisters have golf tournaments and outings. And so you spend 4 hours with four people that you can really get to know, this bond and establish a long-term relationship with. Everything is about connecting.
Well, the deals, as they say, the deals are always made on the golf course.
Amen.
Not at the dinner table. They're made on the golf course.
There you go.
Now, the other thing that I also have seen from talking to past people who have attended the networking conference is that they come back. It's not a one-time event. It's something that they, it's like almost like a family reunion for a lot. They come back, they're coming back home and seeing, you know, the family that they created, that was created around them when they first attended. And what I like about that is that the Power Networking Conference moves people, and this is what we really, really need, community. We need a conference that moves us from hope to how. We are done hoping. Hoping is great. That's faith. We need that. But now we need action. We need how.
That's right. Hope is not a strategy. Hope is not a strategy.
Speak to us about that.
Aspiration. It's an aspiration. It's wonderful. Never lose hope. But then once you have hope, you have to develop strategies and tactics, and then you have to execute.
That's right.
Hope without work, all right, or dream without work, all right, is dead. So yes, that's really, that's the bottom line. I think you said it so beautifully and so succinctly. That's the bottom line. This is, yes, there's always hope, there's always aspirations and inspiration, and there's plenty of that. A lot of inspirational speakers. But most importantly, here are the strategies, here are the tactics, here are the skills, here are the connections, here are the people who can coach you, mentor you, right? Help you. That's what you need. We need help. That's what we need. We all need help. There is no success that you can attain, sustain, or maintain on your own by yourself in a vacuum. You can't do it by yourself. You've got to do it with and through other people. In fact, the most powerful asset that brothers and sisters that you will have in the 21st century will not be your computer or AI. It will be your relationships.
That's right.
Business is about relationships. Without relationships, you have no business. Without relationships, you have no business being in business. In fact, the business we're all really in is the business of building relationships. Where do you go to develop and to get coached and to get mentored and to learn the people that you need to be associated with, attached to, so that you
absolutely can connect, well, that's that transformation part, though, right?
That's right.
That's the, you know, we talked about the information part, but the transformation is that you're not just coming home the same way you left. It's not just something to remember, and you're going to have a bunch of photos on your phone. You're right. Going to have relationships. You're going to have trajectory. You're going to have step-by-step how to and where to go and what to do. And right. Also mostly realize you ain't alone.
Right.
You are not alone. All of us, all of the people, including George, we all have had, as Les Brown would say, you either just left a problem, you're in the middle of a problem, mm-hmm. or you're about to go back in and have to solve another problem.
That's right.
You need to be around the people who eat this kind of stuff for lunch.
That's right.
It's what they do.
That's right. That's right.
And so that's what I love about PNC X, or the experience and the expo, is, yeah, we're not in denial. You're going to go through some stuff.
That's right.
But you're not going to go through it alone. And you're going to go through it with people who probably already have been there, done that, bought the T-shirt, and now they're selling it and making a mint on eBay with it. So that's who you need to be around.
Yeah. No, that's
in this situation. Go ahead, beloved.
I could not have said it better myself. Thank you for having me on the show, because I just love the way you frame it. I mean, if you get the frame right, the picture is beautiful.
Thank
also, what people will not only will leave there with the action steps, the strategies, and the tactics, and the knowledge that they need to take their lives to the next level, to ultimately become our mantra, our theme for FraserNet for the last actually 50 years, almost 50 years, is connect, grow, and prosper, right? Without connecting, right, you cannot grow. And without growing, you cannot prosper.
That's
so
nice.
Our goal for you is to help you connect, grow, and prosper so that you can do the final mission of all Black people, and that is learn, earn, and return. We have a lot of us earning and a lot of us earning, but not enough of us returning, and therein lies our challenge, because nobody's saving Black people but Black people.
Come on with that.
And we ain't saved. Will diversity, equity, and inclusion be an assist? Yeah. You use it properly. You understand it properly. Yes. Yes, it will be assist, but it is not the answer. It is icing on the cake,
fantastic.
Right? But it ain't the cake. We are the cake. That is the icing on the cake. And we know that icing will melt when there's a lot of heat. Are black people under a lot of heat? You damn yes, right. Sir. Right?
But I love that.
Cakes will melt. The icing will melt. We're the cake, and it's our responsibility. There's just no one's, just, you know, it's, and that's how it should be. And we can do this. We are incredible freaking people.
Yes, we
don't,
are.
We have no clue of who we are. We understand our modern history, 400 you know, years, but we don't understand our ancient history. But it's all coming out now. It's all coming out now. It's all coming out.
I've got this up here from Brother Carlos Parks. What's up, my brother? He was one of our Black Excellence brothers that was on the platform. And someone you know, of course, because there's going to be a dedication to him. He says, Dr. Dudley always said, Joe Dudley says, if you want to go fast, you go alone. If you want to go far, you go together.
That's right. I admire that man. He was one of my mentors. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Incredible, incredible human being. So this is the kind of thing. Now, you'll also, because, you know, over the years, we have been able to synthesize and put on a business card. This is the business card. It's two sides. Put on a business card the things that we must do as Black people for the next two generations. It's all synthesized and put on a business card. So you can, you'll get this, it's free. You can put it in your wallet, in your marching orders for the next two generations are right on this card. So I'm gonna read it to you. We call it the frog card. See, there's a little frog in a pot of boiling water there.
Can you see that?
Right. Now, this is true. This is science. This is, we didn't make this up. If you take a frog and put it in a pot of boiling water, it will immediately jump out. But if you take that same frog, put it in some cool water, it will sit there. And if you turn up the heat ever so slowly, incrementally, it will sit there until it boils to death, which is a metaphor for our lives. We don't get with it, right? That's on us. That's why we call it the frog card. So the front side of the frog card says our mindset equals our consciousness. So we have to change our mindset, change our minds, right? And then awaken and change our consciousness. So what are the things that we need to do that will get us to change our mind, to change our consciousness? A, we as a people need a narrower cultural vision, a narrower cultural vision, that we must focus on excellence in making Black people great first. First, Chinese people are working on Chinese people.
Come on, man.
Jewish people are working on Jewish people.
Come on.
Right? Arabs are working on Arabs. They ain't thinking about you. That's who they're working on.
Not at all.
First.
Not at all.
Right. It's our own culture first, making us great first by any means necessary, as Malcolm X said. That's number one. Number two, and this is a little deeper one, but it's short. We have to socially isolate and ostracize.
Woo!
If you are a check this out, Doc.
What?
If you are a Jew of means, and you do not give back and invest in Jewish institutions and Jewish causes, you are socially isolated and ostracized. They don't even want you showing up to the synagogue.
That's right. That's a fact.
We have no such system in our culture.
I love this.
And this is how a Dr. Dre could sell his headphones or earplugs with his partner for almost $1 billion, write a check for $40 million to USC, and not give a penny to historically black colleges, and we still go out and buy his stuff.
Right.
Okay. And I'm not hating on him. I'm just saying that's just.
No, that's a great example of understanding.
Yes. But I think he has since corrected that. Now, he hasn't given HBCUs $40 million like he gave to USC. But so social isolation and ostracize. Okay. So if we have to complain, is what I'm saying, about those of us with significant means and resources that don't give back, we can look at the entertainment and sports world. There are too many of us in that world, we dominate it, who are doing wonderful, but you don't ever hear about them giving anything back to their own people. Now, maybe they're doing it quietly, I don't know. But typically, when a brother or sister does something of means, it makes the news.
Absolutely.
Social isolation and ostracization. Right. What's number three? We have to coalesce around our vision and not just our pain. If somebody puts a book of a young brother or sister, we picketing, we marching, we're all over the place, we're saber rattling. Right? But if you got brothers or sisters talking about, you know, economic development, developing a locally based Black Wall Street, and closing the income and wealth gap, there is no marching and picketing and saber rattling as it relates to that. Certainly, we have to protest pain. But we also need to celebrate, right, and give the same energy to those great ideas, because we have lots of great ideas, and rally around those ideas. That's number two. Number three, we have to connect the dots, right? We have to think networking, leveraging more effectively our collective resources and intellectual capital.
Right? Okay.
The dots, right? There's much to be learned from each other. The future of Black business will be what? Strategic alliances, joint ventures, and partnerships.
That's right.
We must think unity and collaboration, right? Right? What did I say? 16% of the global population are Caucasian. Other 86, 87%. Are melanated people, dominated by people of African descent within the diaspora at 1.5 billion, and Asians at about the same number. So again, we're not outnumbered, we're out organized, right? You connect the dots on that. When we unify and we collaborate and Africa gets its stuff together, game over.
Well, we've seen this, have we not? We've seen what happens, particularly when sisters get together and say, I don't want that person in office. We have seen what happens when we galvanize.
That's right. That's right.
We have, it's not something that we're asking us to do that we don't have any previous DNA to prove. We have that DNA. What we're saying now, particularly with the PNCX conference, is to fortify it. And to develop or start thinking strategically and create a game plan so that, again, this networking conference does not become an event. It becomes part of your life experience. It becomes what you do. You know, it's like PNCX is what I do. Hanging out with people like George Fraser and interviewing my top five and my fave five. That's what we do. Bringing the best of the best to each other is right. What we do. By, you know, years ago, when I was working with people like Mark Victor Hansen and Robert G. Allen, they had this thing called, you know, take a millionaire to breakfast or to lunch.
Right.
Well, this was a great idea. The problem is that none of us knew any millionaires that we could take to lunch, nor could we afford the lunch that we would have to pay for to take them to lunch. Mm-hmm. So with the Power Networking Conference is that you don't have to take anybody to lunch. The network is the conference is going to feed you. You just got to get your butt there.
You got it.
And you're going to be around 6 or 7 figure people who have been there, done that, and are doing it. You need to see what success looks like, community. You know, I'm a jaded guy. I've been doing this for since I launched my .com back in 1998, right? So I've had every major thought leader you can imagine, from presidential campaigning candidate Marianne Williamson, who endorsed my doctorate and my second book, to
I met her. She's
an absolute juggernaut. I had her on because she was talking about reparations. Anything that was a Black agenda, I'm about that. And so I've had all of these huge, you know, successful people, and all of them leave breadcrumbs.
That's right.
All of them leave breadcrumbs. Now, I'm not talking about the person. I'm talking about what they do and what they have done and the contributions to the culture. What Les Brown, the motivational speaker who got me in the seminar game, changed my entire life as a result of that. Talking to people like George Fraser, and if you're not able to talk to him, get the books. Go on Amazon and just type in George Fraser and get, I think it's what, the second or third edition?
Yeah, that's right.
That you're right. In right now?
That's right.
Go and get that. But if you can do a little bit extra, just a little bit, rather than maybe, you know, I know some of y'all might want to go on the Disney cruise. Maybe look at the say, yeah, I think I'm going to take my resources this year. And I'm going to go to the Power Networking Conference. Mm-hmm. And I'm just going to give it a shot. Mm-hmm. Now, I can't make a legal guarantee for you on this platform, but I can guarantee that your life will have far greater positive consequences than just a memory of going on a cruise or going to another party.
That's right.
You already know the outcome, community. Go ahead, Dr. Fraser.
Hello, is there another way to say that? Is if you want to meet important people, you have to be where important people are.
They're not.
You go to them, right? And then try to understand what their needs are.
Right? That's right.
And there's nobody that we're going to have at this conference that if you Google them, that you wouldn't find 100 pages of information about them.
That's so true.
Right.
That is so true.
Find out what, you know, what
power
what
players should... that I know, they don't have a Facebook page in the city.
Right. What pushes their button?
Right.
And then once you understand what pushes their button, what their interests are, then you know how to start a conversation. Right? That's all you need beyond hello. And can you donate to my foundation? Of which you don't want to. You don't meet somebody new and ask them for anything, but you meet somebody. This is what we teach at the conference, because what you're talking about is enculturating our people.
Yes.
That's really what this is about. And that's going to take generations. That's why we're now in our second generation of putting on this conference. This is an enculturation process.
Love that. We're
talking about the same things every year. We don't have 16 new conversations and different topics every time. No. This is what it's about, because there ain't nothing else to talk about. Your money, building businesses, okay, and your family. Right. And understanding the power of the human connection.
And it's a chaining. It's a linkage.
Yeah.
Each one links to the next. And it gets that fabric of that link gets stronger and stronger.
That's right.
It's when you're not there. It's when you don't participate. It's when you just sit back and watch it happen. That's when you become, or we become, the weakest link.
That's right. Right. And that which you do not manage, you will lose. If you mismanage your wealth, you will lose your wealth. If you mismanage your life
Mason
partner,
like that. Let me put that up on screen. Right? Enculturation. So, that's right. He's got a thumbs up. Thank you, Brother Wayne.
You know.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
He understands. Yeah.
It's an acculturation process. It's got to be learned not only at specific kinds of conferences that you have to pick and choose from because there's lots of options, but it also has to be learned around the kitchen table. It also has to be learned in our place of worship, which is the most powerful institution, the Black church, in the culture. Right. This is I live in Cleveland. It has, I think, the second largest Jewish population outside of Israel in the world. And so I have Jewish friends and they have a golf course, of course, and I play with them often. And I've eaten dinner around their table and I've gone to the synagogue just to see what was going on. You know what they're talking about? They're talking about economics and money. When you play golf with them, it's an enculturation process. That's what it is.
I like that consistency
and continuity. So every place, every major thing that we do and or have a propensity to do and or attend, the messages have to be consistent.
We know, sir.
The fundamental message at the Black church is our spiritual and religious growth. Right. Sure. That's their core message, but they can have secondary and tertiary information. And they do. The progressive churches do, where they're talking about building businesses. They're talking about properly managing your wealth, et cetera, et cetera. In fact, entrepreneurship and business building, the first major opportunities we had as Black people began in the Black church.
Right. Very true.
So it's consistency and continuity. So we're in our second generation now of the Power Networking Conference. And then, you know, you've got a handful of our organizations, the NAACP, the Urban League, the Congressional Black Caucus, you know, the big ones, certainly the sororities and fraternities have consistently had major conferences. The question is, what is the content other than the inner workings and the making of a better sorority or fraternity? That's all well and good, but what is the content other than that you're feeding and constantly enculturating into your membership? It's got to be about building businesses, managing wealth, right? Getting back to the idea of family. Because right now we're in an existential crisis around family. That's a whole nother subject we could spend a whole hour on.
Absolutely.
Right. So, but that's up to us. We're the leaders. Doc, you're a leader. I'm a leader. The people that tend to come to the conference are leaders. They're critical thinkers. And this is what we have to have. Absolutely. Critical thinking. And understand how incredible we are.
Right? Well, I like this. I love it because it's something that we can do as a family. We could take the whole family, particularly the kids.
That's right.
And not escape from reality, but actually create it.
That's right.
I like that because most of the time we go on vacation, it's to escape the rat race. Well, can I go somewhere and eliminate this rat race? Can I get off of this treadmill that is going nowhere and all I'm doing is aging out every year?
That's right.
Getting more and more jaded, more and more disenfranchised, more and more minimized and marginalized. White people are going to continue to do what they do. So that we already know. We ain't got nothing to worry about. White people going to do what I think was Shawshe McIntyre said, white people do what white people do because white people do what white people do. So we know they're going to do that.
Yeah, because it's in their best interest.
Exactly.
It's in their best interest to do what they do. And it's in our best interest to do what we need to do.
Yes. 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 Duh. Come on, community. Right. Let's make this happen. Let's make a shift. Because I'm so excited to have you on in the second quarter because it's still early enough in the year. You know how we just went through New Year's resolutions. Oh, I'm not going to bring 2023 and above that into my 2024. Well, some of us have, right? So now, how do I reboot and refocus and not give up on my aspirations, my inspirations? And how do I move from being in a situation of I don't know what I'm going to do to actually having a plan of action? And so this conference, when is it? It's in July?
July 10th to the 13th in Charlotte, North Carolina.
See, you, this is your reboot. Now you are going to be unstoppable for the remainder of the year, but because of the relationships that you're going to meet, because of the workshops that you're going to attend and the assignments that you're going to get, you're going to do like George and myself and all of us do. And that is, you're going to create your new year this year. So as a result, you'll be able to go to this conference and you're already going to be ahead of 2025.
That's right.
You're not going to go into the next year wondering what if. You are going to be decisive and use a level of precision because you're now going to have the contacts and the resources about this. So let's do this as a family. Your thoughts on that, Brother George?
Jim, I couldn't say it any better than that. I mean, I don't want to complicate anything you said. I just wanted to settle in, right? But be in the house. Yeah. Be in the house. I mean, that's really, you know, the river cuts through rock, not because of its power, but because of its persistence. We must persist.
Absolutely.
Whatever hard road you may see ahead of you, stay the course.
Absolutely.
Persist. Nothing lasts forever.
That's right.
Your growth is critical because at the end of the day, behind every strong person is a story that gave them two choices, sink or swim.
Come on.
And I ain't sinking.
Come on now.
Right?
That's right. That's right.
What they throw at me, I ain't sinking.
That's right.
Will there be obstacles? Oh, hell yeah, there's going to be obstacles. Right? I say this all the time. My favorite quote outside of the Bible is one by Marcus Aurelius. Marcus Aurelius was one of the five great Caesars. There were 40 Caesars. He's one of the five great ones. He said this 600 BC. He said, the impediment to action advances the action. What stands in your way becomes the way. In other words, obstacle is the way. Where there is no obstacle, there is no way. What is the first thing God does when he gives you an assignment that he feels that you have for? He puts an obstacle in your way. And your job is to find a way all around, through, and under that obstacle to stumble, fall, make mistakes, and learn the lessons. You learn through failure. You don't learn anything through success. You fail. So you need to overcome obstacles. And when you do that, you get an attaboy and an attagirl from God. And then you get your next assignment at a slightly higher level. And then what's the next thing God does? He puts an obstacle in your way. And again, your job is to find a way over around. And then if you look at your life, that's the story of your life. In fact, if you're going down a path where there is no obstacles, the path probably will not lead anywhere.
No.
Obstacles don't.
You're going to become extinct.
Obstacles don't block the path. Obstacles are the path.
I love that. I love that. I've changed. Obstacles. I love this. Is what happens when you're around these geniuses. I love it.
I eat obstacles for breakfast.
Tell me I can't do. Yes, you do.
Tell me I can't do. That inspires me.
It's good for fiber, too. It's great for fiber. It's great for the colon.
Right. So I just make a simple statement in the quiet of my own mind when you put an obstacle in my way.
Yes.
Watch this.
Right. Right. Exactly. Right. Exactly. That being said, my beloved, last question, comments of your time that is precious to us. One of the guys that I absolutely love, we both love, is Ryan Ray. You just recently did his what is it called? Get Serious seminar.
Get Serious. Oh yeah, I love that title. Yeah.
It's the best.
Great title.
And I would he was kind enough to invite me to be a virtual fly on the wall. I was in the Zoom meeting with you and him. And a few other juggernauts. I think it was Dr. Jimmy Davies, my mentor, and I think Tony Jackson was there, and a few others. And you told a story. If somebody asked a question that he iterated to you, and I'm going to do the same thing in my own way. And I think it's important for the community watching to hear this, because we're always talking about unity, and now we have that. We have something that can unify us. But we also have another conversation, and that is the unification, because there is a direct, distinct, systemic divide and conquer strategy to separate Black men and Black women.
That's right.
And to annihilate Black families, la familia. It's not accidental. Nothing is wrong with Black and with Black men and Black women coming together. Something is happened to them, to us, and it's still happening. George, you had an amazing understanding of this. I want you to share that with the community, and I have some research to be able to actually back that up.
Yeah. It's one of the reasons we're going to have a couples panel.
Nice.
First time, a couples panel.
Wow.
Because Black family, in particular Black marriage, is quite frankly, from my perspective, in an existential crisis at this point. That Black marriage today is at 34%. When I was a kid, now I'm close to 80, marriage was at 85%. Today it's at 34%, and with the current analysis of the metrics driving the reduction of Black marriage, within the next decade it will be down into the teens. Now, that has a severe impact on, as you pointed out, family. Now, why is that so important? There's no culture in the history of humankind anywhere in the world that has risen, to maximize their full human potential without family being at the center of that culture.
Come on, teach us. Absolutely, 100%.
Right? So that's the meta reason we ought to be concerned, right? Family. We know, for example, what Hispanics' mantra is. And you said it.
La familia.
La familia. That's their mantra.
Yeah.
Hell, they name stores after that. They name products after that. Right? I mean, that's at the center.
Absolutely.
Of that culture.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And that is disintegrating. There are some underlying foundational situations, if you will, issues that is driving that apart. And that is the current conflict between the Black male and female. There's a long history how it has gotten to this point.
Mm-hmm.
I can say that when I was growing up, Black women needed Black men because the opportunities for Black women 80 years ago, we had just gotten our right to vote, you may be 40 years before that. It's not what it is today. And they were dependent upon a provider and a protector. So we was all married, right?
Yep.
Now, fast forward a couple of generations, of the core messaging from within our own culture to our sisters by their moms, and in many cases their dads, is you must be self-sufficient.
Mm-hmm.
You must be able to take care of yourself. You cannot depend on the Black man. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily because he is being attacked at every possible angle by the wider world.
Right. Even before birth. Yeah, in pre-birth. Right? Yeah.
Right? Right. So his opportunities will be continually less than yours. And therefore, you have to be prepared and you have to be educated and ultimately be self-sustaining, right? So our sisters have been prepared to a great extent to fulfill that vision they were taught and modeled, right? By their parents. In the meantime, that created some conflict, mm-hmm. if you will, between the Black male and the Black female. And marriage, and again, I could articulate the conflict, but I don't want to take that much time. The Black marriage has begun to disintegrate. Now it's down to 34%. So we're going to have to, it's up to us, no one's going to fix that but us. We're going to have to rethink what marriage looks like
mm-hmm.
in the 21st and 22nd century for us. We know what it's mm-hmm. going to look like and families going to look like in other cultural groups,
mm-hmm.
but at the rate it's deteriorating in our culture, what will that really look like unless sure. there's a change of mindset and consciousness around its importance?
Facts.
There are more Black women in law school, medical school, dental school, graduate programs. Our Black women are outperforming and out-earning men,
mm-hmm. right?
So the whole thing has flipped. And that's
not designed that way. It's designed that way.
Yes. And Black men are under a lot of pressure, not only to yes. get that right, right, but to claw their way into viable equal opportunity, whether it's business, whether it's climbing the corporate ladder. I mean, a corporation yeah. would much rather recruit a sister, because it's a twofer,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and a woman, and I'm sure that they are smart, or mm-hmm. they would not be up in there, right? Mm-hmm. So that's a wonderful thing, but it has created this divide. So what will cohabitation be defined as and look like for the balance of this century and the next century to come? Will it be the model, the old school, I'm old school, model of traditional marriage?
Mm-hmm.
Will it be a marriage without a legal contract, just mm. the justice of the peace is, I want to be with this person for the rest of my life, but I don't want to sign a contract. Will it be what is called a situationship,
mm-hmm.
that you cohabitate based on the combined situation, right? What will that look like? Now, it has already had profound impact. Let's look at some of the fallout. On our wealth.
Mm-hmm.
You look at median household income. This is the latest survey, November of 2022. Here's what earning by cultural group looks like in America today and the marriage rate. East Indians have replaced white people at the top of median household income, annual median household income, $124,000 a year. What's the marriage rate in the East Indian culture? 94%.
Wow.
Number two, which has replaced white people, are Chinese and Asian people. And their annual median household income is $109,000 a year. What's the marriage rate? 61%.
Mm.
White people are now third. And the annual household income is $81,000. And marriage rate is around 57%. And the Hispanic culture is at $63,000 annually. And the marriage rate, 67%.
Mm.
Black people are at the bottom. We're last. Annual median household income, $53,000 a year.
Mm.
What's the marriage rate? 34%.
Mm-hmm.
66% of Black men are unmarried. 71% of Black women are not married. 29% of Black women will never get married. 70% of our children are born out of wedlock.
Mm-hmm.
80% mm-hmm. are being raised in a single parent household, principally by the woman.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So it seems to me at this moment, and I'm praying to God that it will change, that our sisters would rather have a baby than to be a wife. That seems to be the mindset. That's not healthy.
No.
For building.
That's depopulation.
That's right.
That's because self-eugenics.
That's right. Yes. It takes two. It takes two. So if 80% of our kids are being raised in a single parent household, principally by women, the models that they need, you see, children need both female and male energy.
Absolutely.
So let's say you're raising a daughter. Your daughter needs a male model in her life to help her ultimately determine the kind of man she would want in her life.
Mm-hmm.
The father is that man. And the son obviously needs a man in his life because mm-hmm. he's looking to see what kind of man he should be.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So now also they need a female. The son needs a female because he's looking at what kind of wife should, I mean, I want to get the kind of wife that models what my mom has
absolutely.
Been
able
to, right? And so male-female interaction in raising of children, this is biblical. I'm not making this up, right? This is biblical. It's critically important. It is not what's happening in our culture at this yes. moment in time. So we have to fix this. How long will it take? It will take at least 3 to 5 generations. It will take a complete shift in mindset. But now, I must admit, we are very creative people.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
This is why I said, I'm wondering what partnership, male-female partnership, will look like
mm-hmm.
in the 22nd century? Will it be situationship? Will it be that we get back to the cohabitation legalized by marriage?
Mm-hmm.
Or would it be cohabitation where we just make a vow, but there's no contract?
Mm-hmm.
So this is a very, very important issue because, as I said, there is no culture anywhere in the world that has risen where family is not at the center of that culture. It is important for legacy, and it's important for succession.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So it's a deep problem, and I'm not hating one either one of the groups. Now, there's another sort of ticklish issue.
Uh-oh.
Between Black and men. This is something that's very difficult to talk about, and you've got to be very careful when you talk about this. And it may, let's call it cosmetic.
Uh-oh.
All right.
No, this might be my last YouTube family. I just want y'all to know I've really enjoyed you for the last, you know, since 2007 we came up. Right. This will probably be our last broadcast right here. Go ahead, Dr. Fraser.
This may be your last Zoom call.
This might be my last one, but I'll be back after the Power Network conference. I'll be back.
Now let's get it clear. Brothers love Black women.
Yes, sir.
And we love them curvaceous, which is the way God has designed them.
Yes.
We typically love them a little bit thicker.
Absolutely.
We do. We just do. Right?
Pretty in the face. That's what we say. That's right.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. That we love that. Right? And of course, men are visual. Worm on the hook. First, I mean, it may only last a day, but it's just what we see, whatever. Absolutely. Whatever floats your boat, you know, and beauty's in the eyes of the beholder, right? So, but we are visual first. What is happening, there are a number of reasons for it, is that the average sister today at 5'4", is 187 pounds. Mm. The average brother at 5'9" is 191 pounds. Is good. So our sisters are now bigger than our men. So I say all that because there are two issues there. One is excessive weight on a small frame is not healthy. We want them to live a long and fruitful life. It's not healthy. And one of the reasons we suffered on a per capita basis, more diabetes than anybody else.
Right.
That's part of the cause of diabetes. It's not the only cause. So there was a time, and again, I'm OG, when we would pick our wives, when we got married, we would pick them up and we would carry them over the threshold. Or when it was time to be intimate, we would pick them up and gently lay them on the bed. We can't do that anymore.
No, we have to have apparatuses for that.
I didn't say that, though.
That was me. That was Rare Stock. Yeah, we got to have some wheelbarrows and things like that, some straps and things.
So that may sound superficial.
No, it doesn't. It doesn't. I know it's going to hurt. It's going to land a particular way because.
But we want you to continue to be.
We have to have these hard conversations.
We want you to continue to look beautiful and be curvaceous, right? And we want you to be healthy.
Absolutely.
Healthy.
Well, You're making a great point. The reason we're not healthy is because we're so freaking stressed out.
That's right.
From what is happening to us. Again, this is why this conference and not just the conference, but all of the things therein, you know, signing up to the mailing list and getting information about the conference, about the speakers, about the techniques and technologies that will be taught there. All of that is part of your external growth. But let me go back for a moment, beloved. And come forward with some confirmation on what you just shared. There's a reason. There's a divide and conquer strategy that's been in place for quite some time. Now, a lot of my people on my platform know that between 1664 and 1681 is when white people were invented as a matter of law in the United States of America. There's no such thing as a biological white person. quite is an ideology, not a biology.
It's a made-up social construct.
It's a completely made-up social construct. Now, that being said, when anti-miscegenation laws came into play in response to Bacon's Rebellion, this was already noodling in the idea and the concept and the mind of the Europeans and the plant owners. Now, back then, wealth was being fat and chubby.
That's right.
Because it showed you didn't have to have, you didn't do any labor. To be chiseled and to be buffed means you were a laborer and you were less than.
Right.
Now, that was for both indentured servants, slaves. That was just the law and the lay of the land. But what also was happening is that they discovered there's not enough women for these planters. So the king sent a shipload of blue-eyed, blonde women to come here to plant with the planters. Well, unfortunately for the planters, when they got off the boat and they saw Michael B. Jordan's body and Idris Elba's body, and they saw all of this what Spike Lee would call jungle fever, that's what happened. They ended up marrying the indentured servants and slaves, and these European colonists were furious.
Yes.
Along with the fact that in Bacon's Rebellion, they were stealing back the land, they were stealing back the goods and artifacts that were stolen from them. And everybody got together. Poor people got together. All the ethnicities got together and banded under this thing called Bacon's Rebellion. So they decided to put in what was now known as a divide and conquer strategy. And that was the invention of white people. And then backed by what we call anti-miscegenation laws. Most of us know, and this is the work of Dr. Jacqueline Battaglia. Go get her book, Birth of a White Nation, best thing you'll ever do to really understand exactly why. Nothing's wrong with black people. This is what has happened to black people. There were three laws that came out. The first law was a person of African descent could not vote or run for office, right? So that's taking away political power and power to be a part of democracy. The second law was a person of African descent could not own guns or gunpowder. So now George and I cannot feed ourselves, feed our families, nor can we protect ourselves and protect our families. Are you beginning to see how this is going?
Right.
And then the third law was a person of African descent could not take any type of legal action against this new false designation of humanity called white people.
Sure.
So do you see now, as a result of those three laws, it gave white men, this new designation of white men, access to all women. But we lost access to our women because we could not protect them, we could not feed them, we could not support them without getting the entire family killed. That is still the epigenetic, decontextualized trauma that is plaguing us today. And then look at what our brothers, like Dr. Fraser, went through. If any one of us have gone through Jim Crow, 96 years of Jim Crow, you have decontextualized trauma inside of you. You're a walking bag of trauma.
That's right.
You are, as a black man, all a black man had was coming home to some sense of someone loving him and accepting him and seeing him. He had nowhere else to go, which is why I'm saying today we're in this neo Jim Crow. It's a new version, but it ain't changed. Look at the policies that they're turning back. It's going back into making us not allowed to be black men, to show black authority, to protect ourselves, to feed ourselves and our families. And so now you're seeing all of these blended families. I can save you. I'm the white man. I'll come and save you, black woman, from those wretched, no good, nothing a Negroes that are out here, those NANs. I'll save you. That's what's happening, and you must be able to see that community, talking to my sister specifically, because what George just shared with us, I just shared the history and the science and the law behind that. This is a system. Go ahead, Doc.
Yeah. So let's end this on a positive note. What do Black men want from Black women? And what does a Black woman want from a Black man? Now, I can sort of speak with a little bit of authority because I've been married to the same sister for 51 years. Okay.
Yes.
So I'm speaking out of not only personal experience, but just, you know, I've given over 3,500 talks, written 6 books, have been put on this conference, for almost a quarter of a century. And I ask a lot of questions. What does a Black man want from a Black woman? The first thing he wants is peace. Our job is to go out in the world because our job is to provide, to wrestle with the bear, to deal whatever we have to deal with, to make sure that we can provide properly. And when we come home, we want peace. I'm not saying that Black women don't want that too. They do, but certainly we want peace. What's the second thing? Respect. We're not respected as we would hope we would be out there in the world at the levels that we should be. We certainly want it at home. Obviously, we want intimacy.
Mm-hmm.
We want friendship.
Mm, yes.
We want support, trust, and approval. We want you to be our number one cheerleader.
Absolutely.
That's what we want from you. What do you want from us? Well, you put your hand on the Bible and you say the first two things, to provide and to protect. To provide for the family, wonderful. If you choose to work and you've prepared to work and that's your decision, that's icing on the cake, but I need the cake. Ultimately, the responsibility of providing is on us. So you want provision and you want security. You want us to be able to protect the family, right? So we're sleeping upstairs in the bedroom and there's rattling downstairs in the kitchen and all the lights are off. I have to get out of the bed and go down and check it out. Now, if you have to do that, you got a problem. Okay. You got a problem. Just remember now.
Nice.
I'm the king and you're the queen. And the minute that reverses, you got
Houston, we got a problem.
Right. Now, what's the other thing? Things that a woman wants from a good man. They want non-sexual intimacy or affection. Non-sexual. Yes. Right? Touching. Holding, kind words, touch, you know, right? That's non-sexual.
Absolutely.
We want, women want open communications.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, you want your husband to lead. To lead.
Absolutely.
Which means that you must, in a very, very smart way, submit to his leadership.
Oh, you just put the S word in here, Dr. Fraser. That's the S word. Submit. Wait a minute. Now, hold on. You had me at hello, Dr. Fraser.
I
was following everything that you were saying.
That's right. Now, if you lead, leading, it doesn't mean that when a man is leading, he is not discussing and
we're coming to some sort of dictatorship.
But at the end of the day, it's the man's decision. At the end of the day, it doesn't mean that we don't communicate and agree, but at the end of the day, we decide. One final little fact. What is the number one reason for divorce? It's Does anybody know what the number one reason for divorce? And by the way, 80% of divorces are filed by women. What's the number one reason? So it's not what you think. You're probably thinking money. The number one reason for divorce is science. It's uncommunicated expectations.
And
that's something you wanted from your man. You need it from that man. You never spoke of it. You expected him to read your mind, and over a long period of time, whatever's long for you, he did not deliver that which you wanted. That's what you expected from him. Divorce. That's the number one reason. Uncommunicated expectations. So open communications is what's needed from both the man and the woman. People ask me all the time, Dr. Fraser, how did you stay with Nora Jean for 51 years? What's the secret? I said, oh, it's one word. Amnesia. That's the word. Because in 51 years, Dr. Fraser is going to do something stupid and make a mistake, or mistakes. And so is Nora Jean. When we do something stupid and make our mistakes, we come together. We have open communications. We reach middle ground. We then bless it and release it, never to bring it up again.
Ah, Shay. Thank you for that, Elvin. That's what we need. Thank you.
So when we start fulfilling what our women need, and vice versa, partnerships, marriages that sustain themselves over a very long period of time. Because remember the deal, till death do us part. That's a hell of a thing to say to somebody. All right? And don't say it if you don't mean it.
Right.
And then do the work to sustain it.
That's right.
Because it will not be easy. If it was easy, why would God need you?
Oof. I love it. Yeah. Well, that, my beloveds, is how you end a discussion with a powerhouse known as Dr. George Fraser. And so what we do on this platform is we give what's called ankhs, the highest level of thanks, the mayor, the unconditional love and thanks to Amma, which is the first sound linguistics that we invoked as our divine. And so it later became God. God is a Germanic word, but we're trying to go back to our first frequencies and utilize those frequencies. Mm-hmm. Amma is that power. And we also give power and thanks to our ancestors, because it's Amma and our ancestors that sustain us, that has sustained Dr. George Fraser for 79 amazing years, about to be 80. And still look, as Les Brown would say, looking good, feeling good, and smelling good. I mean, we don't die, we multiply. That's what we do.
That's okay. Right.
And so we have to give thanks for that, because here's the truth of the matter. Because we are the first people made in the image and likeness of Amma, of the Creator, everything that we could possibly need to survive and thrive is already coded within our DNA. We would not have a George Fraser. We would not have 20 almost a generation of power network conferences and all of the people that you see and know that have been on this platform if we were not the most resilient, unstoppable, unrepeatable entity on this earth. We are it. We are our savior. There's nobody coming to save us. We are it.
That's right.
And so that being said, we use this affirmation to solidify just how awesome we are. I'll repeat it, George, if you can repeat it after me. And that is. I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is. My good friend, Dr. George Fraser, stick around with me in the green room as we sign off. I don't know about y'all, but I haven't had enough of him. But I know he's got a, you know, he's got another interview he's got to do. He's always doing interviews and shows. He's amazing. I don't know how he does this. But we're going to have him back. But I think what you have experienced today, community, as I always try to bring you the best of the best of the best, this is one of my personal bests. When it comes to business, when it comes to consciousness of what Black power, Black excellence, Black family is about, I go to the guy that's done it and is still doing it. And that's Dr. George Fraser. There are links, community, in the chat, as well as in the description, for you to get everything Power Networking Conference and more. This is not just the end of this. This is the beginning. We'll see you next time on First Frequency of One.